I stand before you now as though I've never sinned. The day I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. Start the day the war begins. Nailers remind me of my sin. Time and time again, your truth is my storm that I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far?
In the presence of God. Thank you. As we prepare to worship God through our giving, we want to thank all of those who give online, and there is a, we want to appreciate all the support they have been given during the years, and there's a link that you could give through that process. And you can't be God-given no matter how hard you try. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and all that dwell within belongs to him. So we are just grateful to be able to give back to God a small portion that he so richly blessed us with. Thine own have we given thee. see some smiles. Wave over to somebody that you're not mad at anybody. So some smile. I know it's dreary outside, the rain. I was telling, I've never seen so many cars on 485 at 7:30 in the morning coming in. And I said, oh God, just get me there safe. So hey, that's it. If we have any children that's 3 through 1st grade, go to, who's that, Ms. Michelle? For children's church this morning. All our children, 3 to 1st grade. And now let me stand and enjoy, join in the song this morning. Presence of God. And what a wonderful song as we go in prayer to the throne of God. And many times we get correspondence verbally that the church would pray for certain folks. But then you are here also. And sometimes you don't have to speak audibly of what you're going through, but you can see the expression on your face. There are concerns that sometimes we try to rationalize, but with God, all things are possible. Thank you, praise team, for reminding us that sometimes we can't go but so far, and God meets us right where we are. Amen? So while we're doing it, let's go to the throne of grace as we keep the Peggy Wilman family in prayer. And even some of you right now, maybe there's someone you'd like to call out that we lift up during this time of prayer. It may be okay today, and it's Sunday, but Monday's coming. And we don't know the day or the hour when we need someone to lift us up in prayer. Let us go to God in prayer. Oh, Lord, my God, when I'm in awesome wonder, consider all the world thy hands have made. We pause to reverence you, Lord, in the midst of our worship. For you, O God, sit high and look low and know every need and desire before we even ask. Lord, we thank you for being our creator, our provider, and control of all things. And Father, we come to you empty, to be filled with your spirit, to allow us whatever we are going through, to remind us that you are here with us. And then there are some times where you carry us. I pray right now that you touch that man, woman, boy, or girl in this sanctuary or throughout this world, the families in this community, our country, and universal. But Father, your hands are bigger than our hands. And you said no good thing you will behold from those who love you. We love you, Lord. But we come asking for forgiveness for all our sins and transgressions. Block out all our iniquities that we may receive a fresh anointing from you. As we come through a week of praise with our general conference, I pray, oh God, that we be mindful that we can't do nothing without you. Prick the hearts and minds of the people who may not understand, but in the midst of it all, none of us know it all. But we'll know when we stand in front of you that day to know the things that so secretly we don't know right now, that you will open everything out to us. But always being mindful whether we are disappointed in the outcome or whatever decisions we make, we know that your grace is sufficient. For any circumstance or situation, no matter what we're going through, your grace, Lord, has provided us an opportunity to come into your house of worship and to praise you one more time. But we don't know what tomorrow may bring. So, Father, I ask that you bless this church and every church under the sound of my voice that will be a beacon light, that somebody may come to know you and say, I yield, what must I do to receive this gift of salvation? What must I do to honor you? Continue to bless us, Lord, as we continue to do your work, not just for a point of time, but for a lifetime, that we'll be able to do your good and perfect will. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord, let the people of God say, amen. What a mighty God we serve. Now, I've had breakfast with the United Methodist men, so y'all pray for me. I normally don't eat like that first thing in the morning, but pray for me. Let us stand and read our scripture this morning. One verse is coming from Matthew, Gospel, chapter 5. We're dealing with verse 6 this morning. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after justice. Some words say righteousness, for they shall have their fill. You may be seated in the presence of God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Will you pray with me, please? Guide me, O thy great Jehovah, for I'm just a pilgrim in this barren land. Your servant is weak, but you are mighty. Lord, I need you to hold me in your mighty hands. Send your anointing that makes preaching easy. Allow your word to go forth and not return void, but accomplish what it set out to do. For your word is true. Now, Lord, the word is yours. The spirit is yours. And we are yours. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. If I were to ask you this morning, what would make living worth the effort in our time here? I would get very few responses. You may say some things like success. Some might say I'm living for significance. And some for security. We all have our opinion of what God has given us in this life. And our journey every day, and some may even, a list may go on and on with some things we never heard. But God has given us this life, and we are to use it to the fullness. A young lady asked me, an older seasoned woman asked me one day when I was pastoring a church, and she said, Pastor, I don't feel like I've been to church if I don't recite the Apostles' Creed. So when I was wrestling with trying to bring this message through the Beatitudes, she asked me, she said, well, let me ask you something. What do you draw from the Apostles' Creed? Do you know the true meaning in it? She said, no, I just like reciting it. So I gave a 7-week sermon on the Apostles' Creed. The same thing with the prayer that we normally call the model prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father. Many recite that prayer, but do you really know the meat and nuts and bolts to that? Do you understand what Jesus was actually saying? So I did another sermon series on the model prayer that we pray sometimes. Sometimes we could get so familiar, I'm going somewhere, we could get so familiar with the scripture until we really grasp the understanding. And that's the same thing with the Apostles' Creed. The same thing with the model prayer, but also in the Beatitudes. All these are more, we allow ourselves to develop our character by scripture. Notice, if you will, the first four Beatitudes is how we vertically communicate with God. Vertically. The last four is how we horizontally deal with mankind. That won't cost you nothing. I don't know how many knew that. But if you look at it closely, there is a vertical relationship with us and God, but there's also a horizontal with mankind. In other words, we have a responsibility after that. We understand from the text that Jesus' message on the north shore of Galilee may have disturbed some of them. Here he had this large following, a broad audience, along with the disciples, and he dealt with this this particular verse. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And I mean, Jesus is very observant. He probably felt these people been traveling for a while, they're a little hungry, probably heard a few stomachs growl. I'm just only exaggerating. And he said, well, let me throw this in here, so I could tell them about my, somebody get that next week. Let me throw this in there. He said, I have mentioned before in the first part of this, the Beatitude contains Jesus' desires for us, but also we are blessed assurance to carry them out. Jesus set heaven and earth in perspective during this Beatitudes. If you read the text and you look at it very closely, we are to adopt those things that he is telling us. And finally, we emphasis on our relationship to God and also to our brothers and sisters. Look at the people who were following him. They were aware of poverty. They were aware of mourning. They were more even being in control by other people. So they understood those in the literal meaning. But Jesus regained their interest with his 14th Beatitude here. Jesus probably noticed that they were looking for something greater. So he said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. What is the challenge here? Many are seeking happiness when they should seek righteousness. Those who make happiness the goal in this life seldom really receive happiness, because happiness is just temporary. But when we have the joy of the Lord, knowing that his righteous way of doing things will help us, happiness only lasts for a while. Have you ever ran into somebody who said, "I just want to be happy"? Well, you could go to that local store and get something to make you feel happy. Don't make me go there. But at the same time, instead of seeking happiness, we must seek righteousness, not from people, but from the Lord. That's what he's talking about, righteousness from him. Don't we remember over in the 6th chapter of Matthew's gospel when he reminds us, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and then these other things will be added unto you." Happiness is only temporary. But when we seek his righteousness, everything else lines up together. I don't know about you, the older I get, the less I think about what some people think, what people say, because you're going to a process where that's not mandatory. It's looking to see what God has for me. And what God has for me, he has for me. Happiness is not predicated upon God. He wants us to receive his righteousness. Righteousness and salvation are thought of the same. When we receive his salvation, we receive his righteousness. And when we receive his righteousness, we're in good company, because righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to every believer. It's not something you can't buy, but it comes through faith. And I know sometimes this world beats us up, but then there are some things. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So through Christ, we are made the righteousness of God. 2 Corinthians 5, time won't allow me, verse 21, where let us know that we are righteous because of the righteousness of God. Because only in this world, listen, Christ never becomes a reality to anyone to whom he does not first become a necessity. I'm going to let that stay there a while, because I think y'all missed that. I need to say that again. Christ never becomes a reality in our life to anyone whom he does not first become a necessity. I don't know about you, but who else will you put your faith in? Christ's righteousness. Well, not only with the challenge, he gives the people comfort, and he's given us comfort through this text. The Beatitudes are considered made to be the most challenging for us. Like I say, four is to God, four is to mankind. It's the most challenging, but it's also the most comforting Beatitudes. It's some good words that come out of there. The comfort is that blessing is promised to those who hunger and thirst. Don't get it twisted. You must hunger and thirst for the promises, because each beatitude and each one of them, there's a promise. So it may be a challenge, but he brings up the comfort of knowing he gives us a promise, and I don't know if God ever reneged on a promise. Friends may, but God hasn't. To those who may obtain, you must understand, this is not something that he's going to press on. You must hunger and thirst for his righteousness. Too many times we allow our circumstances, situations, or we want to blame somebody else. But when we hunger and thirst for God's righteousness, then we're in good category. We're allowing him to minister to us. We're allowing him his way. The reason that people reject Christ is that they do not desire enough to become a Christian. What it is to become a Christian? They don't have desire. This world can make us happy, but it cannot bless us. It has to be a desire enough to become a Christian. Many people hunger and thirst for pleasure, prestige, positions, possessions, even wealth. And these things are okay if you receive them, but they also, for the true Christian, there must be an added priority in which it is. They should not overwhelm us when God is put first and all these other things will be added. Sometimes God blesses us to be a blessing. So we're not ruling out those things, but where all your energy and priority goes, you must seek Him for that comfort. The Christian does not say, I'm interested in Christ, or he or she says, for me to live is Christ. No, the Christian does not say, I would like to come to terms with Christ. He or she must say, I surrender all to Christ. I used to love those who are old enough, the Billy Graham Crusades. I surrender all. And it's one of those things that we have a tendency to do. We say we trust, we love God, we trust Him, but we just want to give Him a little bit of what we have and keep the rest to ourselves. No, it must surrender all. And when we surrender all to Him, that's when His promise comes. It's just a challenge, but yet it's also the comfort of knowing that He will not renege on a promise. When the last time you truly trust God and allow Him to show His provisions? God is constantly working miracles every day. God is still opening doors that no man can shut. God is still moving in a miraculous way with anything that we know in life. Who do you put your trust in when those things don't line up with what you are challenged with? But He has a way of bringing that comfort. But I love this part, also the promise. Jesus said, the Christian who hungers and thirsts for righteousness shall be filled. Because there are times when, I don't know about you, but I experienced it, that you feel empty. Life sometimes could beat you up to a point where you just feel empty. It's almost like driving your car and you're riding on fumes. I hope I get there before I run out of gas. And we too do the same thing. Some of you right now, probably not in this church, but somewhere, it's running on fumes. Wondering how they're going to make it. But Jesus said, the righteous, don't miss this, shall be filled. In other words, He steps in, and with His providential grace, with His way of anointing, He touches those innermost parts of us that no other man, human hands can touch. Oh, that's a shout on that one. That's the kind of God we serve. The Christian with a spiritual appetite grows in the Christian life. I'm sorry, I put a lot of money in school and all the training, but yet still, it's not enough to learn the grace of God. It's an ongoing process. Nobody has arrived yet. Constantly, with that spiritual appetite to know more about Him and more about me and what He's calling me to do. You gotta have a spiritual appetite for Him. Life is not just a haphazard and just do your own thing. No, that's how we grow in the Christian life. There's a spiritual appetite. That's why He said, who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And the Christian with a spiritual appetite receives a peace of mind. Now, I did this one time before, and I asked the audience, I said, how many want to go to heaven? Everybody raised their hand. I said, how many want to go now? How many takers did I get? Not too many. But it's a spiritual appetite receives a peace of mind. What come may, God has given me the promise, and He's working this situation out in my behalf. He never reneged on a promise. I love David. If you look at Psalms 22,
David was going through a rough time, and all those psalms are not books. They're not chapters. They're books. And David in Psalms 22 is going through a rough time. Boy, you just feel sorry for David. But then he writes that next book, Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He made me to lie down in green pastures. In other words, he's still making provisions. He lead me beside the still waters. See, sheep are very timid, and the thing with sheep is they get all upset when you run by running water. He lead me by still water. So when I'm going through something, God has a calmness that he brings. Oh, I hope somebody get this for next week. That's why he said he'd be laying me beside the still waters. But then he put his cap on it. He restored my soul. Because we come to a point sometimes, how much more, Lord? Have you ever did that before? Lord, if another thing happened today, I don't know what I'm going to do. No, he restores your soul. Don't give up. He restores your soul. And I like what C.S. Lewis, I love C.S. Lewis. I don't take credit for this, but this is what he said. If you read history, quote, you will find that the Christians who did the most for this world were those who threw the most of the next world. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this, end of quote. In other words, people who make the biggest difference are not just thinking about right here. They're thinking about what's going to happen when I go to the new world. But it don't allow them to put that on hold waiting. We all want to go to heaven, but the work is to be done now. That's what he's saying. It's a difference in just waiting to see. God has orchestrated all of us to do some things while we're here. Do the work while it's day, because night will come when no man or woman will be able to do anything. And the character of any disciple of Christ is the foundation of his and her ability. Not just make impressions, but make an impact on this world. We are here to make an impact, not an impression. They probably say some rosy things about you when they're laying there looking at you in that casket. But what impression? It's more important is making an impact to allow God's name to go on. His righteousness. Seek his righteousness. Hunger and thirst for his righteousness. And all these other things. He'll give you desire of your heart. Will be added unto you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let the church say, amen. We serve a mighty God. And when we put our priorities in order, God will keep his promise. Tara, if you will come, and as we get ready for the Lord's Supper, what a mighty God we serve. And he's enabled us to see this another day. There was an old man who used to always wake up every morning and say, Lord, another day's journey. And he is right. We're all on a journey. But our journey is no good unless we seek God's righteousness. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. And in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You have made from one every nation and people to live on all the face of the earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death. And made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night when he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do that as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And as we recite that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, those who request gluten-free, we have gluten-free bread also. You just come up and just raise your hand and we'll make sure that you get that.
Yeah.
bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior, isn't he wonderful? Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the word of the treasure you found.
Now you have some homework on verse 7 of the Beatitudes. You have your assignment? Okay. We have gone through half of them already, and we're going to go through the next half in these next upcoming weeks. Let's not forget the gathering space to sign up for the Pentecost party. I thought Rhonda Hill and Renee Hughes would be there at 9 o'clock. Rhonda's supposed to be here for 9 o'clock. Is she out
they're
there?
Here.
Okay.
Here.
Please, ma'am, please, sir. Let's make it a big thing for our Pentecost party. And also to keep those in prayer for those who are struggling right now. And traveling mercies for the staff. So let us stand with our last song here as we get ready to go home.
You are here, moving in our midst.
Lord, that is who you are. And we'll be mindful that we understand that you're God all by yourself. And we pray, oh God, that we hunger and thirst for your righteousness. For we know we can't do nothing without you. Now may the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide in each and every one of us. As we part from this place, but never from your presence. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, let the people of God say, amen.